Are you a procrastinator? I am. Part of it is that I love the rush of getting things done at the last minute. And part of it is because I just get overwhelmed sometimes with everything that needs to get done. They say that there are two things that are certain in life. You know this? Death and taxes. So let's talk about taxes. I have this box. It's a filing box. And all year long, all of my receipts, all of our medical stuff, all of our tax documents, all of the things that are part of our tax filing, they go into that box. And by the end of the year, it's full. It's like overflowing. And I look at that box every year and I go, oh, when is that tax filing due? When do we need to get those taxes done? And I look at that pile and I'm overwhelmed because I've got to sort it. I've got to stack it. I've got to go through it and make order out of the chaos that is in that box. Anybody there with me? Maybe not. Oh, I'm so, there's a few of you. Now, here's what happens. Is I know what has to get done. And so I resolve in my mind, we're gonna do it. We have to get this done. And usually it's a good news scenario too. It's not like I owe more taxes, thank goodness. I usually get something back and it's that carrot dangling there. If I get this done, then we'll get a tax return. But still, there's that pile. So, okay, it's time. I've got this day ahead of me. The day is clear. I've cleared my schedule. I'm going to take care of this today. And so what do? I pull out the box. I'm like, oh, I probably need to make sure that I'm well caffeinated for this. So I make myself some coffee. You know, I'm probably just going to be working through the day on this, so I'm going to eat now so I don't have to stop late. So I make myself a nice little breakfast to go along with the coffee. And it's about 10:30 in the morning, and the taxes are still sitting all in the box. And so I open my computer. I'm like, okay, I probably need to have this organized. I should have my spreadsheet ready to go. So I work on my spreadsheet. And we get halfway through the day, and none of the receipts have moved from the box. How often does this happen in our lives where because we are overwhelmed, because we don't know where to start, because we're not certain of ourselves, we focus on all the wrong things before we get to what actually needs to get done? Have you been in that place? I have several kids that are in university. It seems to happen over and over and over again. I have a paper due. I need to take care of this other thing first. Last week, Matt shared with us about Jesus the Messiah that the people of Israel, the people of God were waiting for. And they had a list of criteria that they were looking for in a Savior that was to come. But they were looking for the wrong things. They were looking for a political leader who would rise and free them from the oppression of the government of the day, the Romans that was oppressing them, so that they could be free. But they were focused on the wrong thing. They missed who the Messiah was supposed to be. The Messiah that Jesus promised, the anointed one that was to come, wasn't there to free them politically. Why? Because even if the Messiah that was to come had come and freed them from the Romans, then what? Death is still there. The problem is death. The problem is sin that leads to death. And even though they may be free politically, the problem has not been solved. They are still dead in their sin. The Messiah that was to come was not a Messiah that was bound by these earthly categories. This was a Messiah that was coming to defeat the real enemy, the true problem, to get at the root of it and destroy it once and for all, so that the people of God would be free. Free. Free so that they could live abundantly. Free so that they could pursue eternal life. Free so that they could be in relationship with the God who created them. No matter how fabulous it might seem to have an earthly Messiah who comes and destroys the armies of the wicked and destroys the enemies that are oppressing the society we live in, it still changes nothing. In the eternal sense, it changes nothing about my condition as a human being, broken, suffering, in chains to the darkness that rules in this world. We need a Messiah who comes to free us from the darkness. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 17 through 26 says, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, your faith is futile because you're still in your sins. Because Jesus rises from the dead, because he is a risen Savior, we who have believed in him are also raised to new life. We also have life. We are alive in Christ. If Christ has not been raised, our faith is futile. We need a Savior that can defeat death itself. This is why Jesus comes. In this passage in 1 Corinthians, Paul the Apostle is reassuring the believers that what they have believed in is not in vain. It is the truth and it is the power that gives life to all of humanity. In verses 20 and 20 through 22, it says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who died. For since death comes through a human, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human, the God-man Jesus. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ. The Messiah that is promised is a Messiah that is bigger than the nation of Israel, that comes to free them from a political situation. It is a Messiah for them and for all of humanity, for all of time. It is the one who comes to take the place of all of humanity, to die so that there might be life. You see, Jesus, the Messiah who comes, is the Adam reborn. It is the new Adam. Adam represents all of humanity in the scriptures. And when Adam sins, it represents how sin and brokenness and death enters into the world for all of us. So we need a new Adam. We need someone who will come and reverse what has gone wrong. Jesus is that one. And it's something that couldn't be done by a human that is touched by sin and brokenness. It needed to be someone who was pure and righteous and holy. And so Jesus, the Son of God, divine and human, in one flesh, comes. And through him as the new Adam, death is defeated. Sin is broken. In the Gospel of John, we find the story of Jesus the Christ. He's announced in John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, Jesus was that Word. We hear of His divinity as He comes. But then it goes on to say, in Him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In the Gospel of John, the writer uses the themes of light and dark as metaphors related to the idea of death and life. You see this over and over again throughout the Gospel of John. And here at the beginning of the Gospel of John, he creates this equation where he says, in Him was life, and the life was the light of all mankind. Light shines in the darkness. The darkness cannot overcome it. We're quite familiar with this concept of light and dark. And we've come to grasp hold of this idea that darkness is not a thing. Darkness is nothing. Darkness is the absence of light. Now, no matter how hard I tried to explain that to my 13-year-old self as I turned off the basement light and ran up the stairs, darkness is not a thing. How do we know this? Well, think about it. When you go into a dark room and you hit the switch for the light, how much darkness is left in the room? I expect an answer. How much darkness is left in the room when you turn on the light? None. How long did it take for the darkness to go? Nothing. It would just, you turn on the light, boom, darkness gone. Why? Because it's not like there's this tension between the light and the dark. It's not like there's this struggle between the light and the dark, and the dark is pushing into the light. No, the light comes, boom, darkness gone. The light enters in, the darkness is gone. We can accept that, right? That's just the way it is. John is setting up an equation here in the gospel that he tells us of Jesus' life that says, you know about light and dark, right? Light comes, darkness goes. No fight. That's the way it is with death and life. That's the way it is with death and life. What is death? What is death? It's the absence of life. Just like darkness is the absence of light, death is not a thing. Death is nothing. Death is the absence of life. In John chapter 1, verse 4, it says, in Him was life, and when He comes, that life invades and pervades and fills the earth and the creation that God has made. God breathes life into this world. He breathes life into you and to me. Before God breathes life into the world, what is there? Nothing. It's not like there was this darkness that had to be pushed back, that this darkness that was pushing and fighting against God. No, we don't want any life here. No, there was nothing. And then God spoke, and then God breathed, and life was. John tells us in this gospel that if we want to live in that God life, we got to stick close by. He calls it abiding in Him, remaining in Him. And it says the closer you are to the source of life, the more that you will be filled with that life. So why is it that you and I walk around carrying so much darkness inside of us? Why is it that we feel like we're struggling and pushing back and fighting with death in our lives over and over and over again? Why is it so hard? Why? It's because there is one who wants to deceive us. There is one who is fighting against the light, fighting against the darkness. It is the one who is trying to deceive us. There's no power there. There's only deceit and lies. But when we accept those lies, when we are deceived in our weakness, the life slips out of the holes in the broken places. The light leaks out and the darkness creeps in. It's not that the darkness is fighting us, it's that the light is escaping. So how then will we overcome that darkness and that death? By being filled again and again and again with the light of Christ. In the Gospel of John, we see darkness over and over again. When Jesus meets with Nicodemus, the leader of the Pharisees, who is wondering, and is this the real Messiah? What time of day was it? It was night. It was dark. Why? Because Nicodemus is in the dark. He's not in the life of God. When Judas goes out, when he is determined to betray him, what time is it? It's night. It's dark. Why? Because darkness is all that's left in him. On Easter morning, the morning of the resurrection, in John, what does it say when Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb? John says, while it was still dark, she goes to the tomb. What is he saying? He's saying that for Mary and for the disciples, they thought Jesus, the source of light, was gone. For them, it was nothing but darkness left. And Mary goes to the tomb in the darkness. Hope is gone. The one that they have loved is gone. The desire for a Messiah to come and save them, crushed. When we think of resurrection, we often think of the resurrection as the thing that, you know, Jesus, Easter Sunday, yes, the resurrection. Jesus comes back to life after defeating death. There was Jesus' resurrection. And one day after we die, there will be a resurrection. It's some sort of future thing, a future event. But I want to share with you, brothers and sisters, that resurrection is not just a future event. It's a current reality. It's a reality that we live in, and those who believe in Jesus will never die. In John chapter 11, we have the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead. In John chapter 11, verses 23 and 24, we hear this story and this interchange between Martha and Jesus. Beginning at verse 21, it says, Lord, Martha said, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But now I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Do you catch that? She says, if you had been here, I know that Lazarus wouldn't have died. Why? Because she knows that Jesus can heal. Jesus can repair that which is broken. But here we have this question. Okay, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. How much healing is actually in this Jesus that is coming? We know that he can raise people from the point of death. We've seen that in a few other stories. But here is someone who has already died. Does the power of Jesus to bring life and healing, does it extend beyond the grave? Jesus says to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha, like you and I, responds with the only sane and rational response. I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. I get it. Yeah, thanks. But he's dead right now. But that's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus is not saying the resurrection is something far off that we long for and hope for, but it's way out there. He goes on to say in verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing me will never die. Do you believe this? Jesus is redefining the categories of death and life. He's reminding us that the life that we see and we live in right now is one slice of the bigger picture. And that where Jesus is, there is life even when we are dying in our physical selves. Further, beyond that, he says, John draws this equation in Jesus' words, to believe is to receive life. To believe is to be filled with life. And then the question, so, do you believe? Because if you believe, life is here. If you believe, death has no power. If you believe, you will live eternally. In the story of the resurrection of Jesus, we learn that Jesus' resurrection, it gives us hope for today and for the future. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 26, which we read this morning, says that the last enemy to be destroyed is death. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. The Messiah that comes is the one that destroys the true enemy, the only real enemy, the absence of life. How does he destroy it? By shining light and the darkness flees. By bringing life and death must flee. When the perishable, it says, when this body that we have that grows old and dies, that suffers disease and illness and dies, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, that which can never die, and the mortal, the life that slips away, is clothed with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Has it been a battle and there's back and forth and who knows who's going to win? It looks like the darkness is getting stronger. No, now it looks like the light is getting stronger. No, it's death swallowed up, gone. The victory is complete. You can't even see the remnants of it. It's gone. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Paul says it this way, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have a Messiah, a Savior, who is life. And because he is life, death is broken, death is defeated, and life rules. And even that which has died is returned to life because life fills the room. So the question is, if light defeats darkness simply by entering the space, then is it not true that death is swallowed up by the presence of life? And where is that life? In the person of Jesus Christ. This is why the death on Good Friday, the death on the cross, is a victory. Because the death that is dying is the death of sin, the death of brokenness, the death of the first Adam is broken on the cross, and all that remains is Jesus, the life. And he comes to be with us in the garden as he speaks to Mary, "It's me." And she says, "Oh, my Lord." The question that Jesus asks Martha is this: do you believe? Because this is the boundary between death and life. This is the boundary between darkness and light. Do you believe? Have you said yes to the light that comes in and dispels all the darkness? Have you said yes to the life that comes in and fills us abundantly and to the fullness of the life that we are meant to have, and darkness and death is gone? Do you believe? Those who call Jesus Lord, those who have known the power of the resurrection in their lives, say, "Yes, we believe." Would you say that with me? "Yes, we believe. We believe. He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
And if he is risen indeed, then what do we have to fear? What do we have to worry about? What do we have to be broken by? Nothing. The power of God has filled us." And then Paul says at the end of chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, "Therefore, brothers and sisters," I wish I was a Southern gospel preacher and I could throw all of that in motion. I've got emotion plenty, but "therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you." When do you move? You move when you're uncertain. You move when you don't have enough strength. You move when you're broken and weak. But when you are strong, when you are full of light and life, you don't move. You stand firm. "Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." And this takes us back to the beginning of the chapter. If Christ has not returned from the dead, then our faith is in vain. But he is alive. Amen?
Amen.
We are filled with the life of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So we stand firm. Amen? And we go forth in darkness and weakness and trembling. No. We go forth in the power of Christ and in his name, in lives filled with victory and hope and purpose for the kingdom of God. Let us live in the light of Christ. Let us be filled with the life of the risen Savior. Amen.